Hi folks, I'm Sai Srirampur. I head up the customer success for all Postgres services on Azure. I'm here to talk about Citus from the customer eyes. And in our day-to-day, my team helps customers with data modeling, migration-related aspects, performance tuning, to ensure that there is a smooth customer onboarding journey. So let's get started. Just before we get started, this talk is for multi-tenant SaaS companies who are growing fast. That is, they're onboarding thousands of customers, and they're expecting or already running into scalability issues with their database and want to scale out with distributed PostgreSQL. Second, it is also for companies who are building scalable time series applications, and they want to know how they can leverage a rich PostgreSQL environment to do so. Based on various customer engagements I was part of, I've observed that customers go through four high-level steps to get onboarded to Citus. First, they get to know what Citus is. Second, they analyze whether Citus makes sense for their use case. Third, once there is a use case fit, they go implement a few data modeling practices to best utilize Citus. Fourth is, once the data model is ironed out, they migrate and run the application in production. This talk provides a bird's eye view of the customer journey by probing into each of these steps, and goal is to provide direction and guidance to any customer looking at evaluating and using Citus. Just as a precursor, I won't be doing a deep dive into each of these questions because I won't have time to get it done in 25 minutes, but I plan to give you like very important pointers across each of them. So first question is, what is Citus? Citus enables you to run Postgres that you love at any scale. To achieve any scale, Citus extends Postgres with the superpower of distributed tables. You can start small by building your applications on a single node, the same way you would with PostgreSQL. And as your app scale and performance requirements grow, you can seamlessly scale to multiple nodes by transparently distributing your tables. Number two, Citus is packaged as a Postgres extension and doesn't fork Postgres. This makes Citus Postgres native. That is, it supports the latest PostgreSQL version on the day of its release. Number three, Citus is open source, and there is a fully managed offering on Azure called Azure Cosmos DB for PostgreSQL. Azure Cosmos DB for PostgreSQL is Azure's fully managed distributed SQL offering built upon the core benefits of PostgreSQL. It has multiple features to seamlessly manage production-grade Citus deployments, including automatic high availability, cross-region replication for disaster recovery, private access for enterprise-grade security, one-click experience for provisioning and scale-out, and so on and so forth. Now that you've known what Citus is, let us do a deep dive into the use cases where Citus can bring value. There are many real-world applications across different verticals solving business-critical problems using Citus. All of these can be characterized into two main buckets: multi-tenant SaaS applications and time series applications. And this is what I did like initially when I introduced the audience for this talk, right? So let's drill deep into each of these use cases and understand how, you know, Citus provides value. First, if you're running a multi-tenant SaaS application that is growing fast, that is, you're onboarding new tenants quickly and are expecting to outgrow your single node database, Citus can provide value. The second scenario is you are already having a homegrown sharding solution to manage your, you know, multi-tenant SaaS application. It is complex, it is incurring, you know, large tech debt, and it is very inflexible to scale out and rebalance tenants. In that scenario as well, Citus can provide value. Citus has many specialized features to build scalable enterprise-grade SaaS apps. These features include automatic sharding of tenants across nodes, online scale out to add more nodes and rebalance tenants seamlessly, tenant isolation to isolate large tenants or hotspots to their dedicated nodes and give them, you know, dedicated resources, comprehensive tenant monitoring features based on, you know, what is the size of the tenant, what is the traffic each of these tenants are generating, and so on. And row level security per tenant to avoid cross tenant access. Now let us go through a real world scenario of an application that is running a production grade deployment with Citus. Algolia uses Citus on Azure to power their multi-tenant SaaS application. This application provides analytics on search data, enabling real-time decision-making for Algolia's customers. And the application is used by over 11,000 tenants or 11,000 customers. There are over 10 billion rows stored in two clusters across different regions, and both of them add up to 20 nodes, right? And Citus ensures that 95 percentile of their queries finish within 800 milliseconds at a constant, you know, throughput rate of 100 requests per second. The second type of applications are time series and IoT apps that provide real-time insights on telemetry data, including device telemetry, vehicle telemetry, logs, events, and so on and so forth. These apps have, like, you know, an implicit requirement of scale because the data is actually machine generated, right? Like, hence, you know, they have the potential to grow like big, and they require a database that can scale to multiple nodes. If you're building such apps and want to do it in the rich Postgres ecosystem, Citus can make that happen. Features like horizontal scale out, JSONB to store and index semi-structured data, native time series APIs for partitioning, expiry, and archival provide a ton of value for building such scalable time series applications. I'll do a drill down into each of these in the data modeling section, but this is the reason, you know, like why there is value in, you know, building time series applications with Citus. A real world customer reference in the time series IoT space is HSL. They are responsible for more than half of all the public transportation in Finland. They capture time series data from their network of 2000 buses in real time and provide rich dashboards for vehicle monitoring. The data set size is over a billion rows, and queries that used to take 10 minutes before moving to Citus now finish like instantaneously. And due to the managed service offering on Azure, they were able to save 50% of their ops costs. At this stage, you have decided that there is a potential use case fit. That is, your app is a multi-tenant SaaS app or a time series one looking to scale out with a distributed Postgres ecosystem. Now you want to implement the right data model to make the most out of the database. I've synthesized all the data modeling interventions that we did across, you know, various customer engagements and wanted to highlight like five of them. These five should mostly be enough to make the most out of Citus. First, Citus distributes data across nodes based on the hash of a column. This column is called a distribution column or a shard key. And shard key dictates, you know, the performance and scalability of what you can, scalability that Citus can give you. And I have shared a reference, the blue one at the right end of the screen, which gives more details on the distribution column, why it is important, and how Citus distributes data and queries based on the distribution column. But what we have observed is that, like, you know, a column that adds natural dimension to data is a good shard key, right? And this column typically is the central piece of the application and lives at the heart of the workload. A couple of examples that come to my mind are, you have multi-tenant SaaS apps where, you know, the tenant ID, it could be the customer ID, organization ID, which is a good distribution column. And in an IoT application, right, like a device ID is a good candidate because the data is actually generated by devices and the analysis is also for devices, right? And hence, you know, it is the central part of the application. Here I have an example, if you see, right, like where I have an application to analyze GitHub events, right? And if you see the data model, there are three tables. I have the events table, the users table, and the countries table. Events table captures all the events on GitHub, right? Let it be a commit or a pull request created by users, right? And users represents all the metadata related to user. It could be the username, password, avatar, and all of that. And you have the countries table, which is a smaller dimension table, which is shared across users. In that scenario, user ID is a good candidate for distributing the tables because, you know, user ID is the central piece of the application and events are indeed generated by users themselves and the application is also for users, right? And hence it, you know, adds natural dimension to data. The second tip I have is collocate large tables and make small tables reference. In the GitHub events example, right, like events and users are typically the larger tables as they directly store application related data, right? And to collocate these two tables, if you see, I'm distributing both of them on the user ID column, right? And the countries table is a smaller dimension table that is shared across users. So I can make that table a reference table, and reference tables are tables that are replicated across all the nodes, and distributed tables are the ones that are, you know, sharded or partitioned across like multiple nodes. So I have talked so much about collocating tables. What does this mean and how does it help? Distributing users and events on the same column, which is the user ID, ensures that they are collocated. That is, data for the same users for both the tables is on the same node. This helps perform SQL operations like joins, foreign keys in a distributed environment. For example, joins between users and events table can be pushed down directly to the nodes and can be executed like efficiently without the need of shuffling data across nodes, right? And for the countries table, as it is replicated across all the nodes, joins with it also can be pushed down to nodes and executed very efficiently. Hence, the second tip is distribute the larger tables on a common distribution column. So here for the events and users, I'm distributing on the user ID and making the smaller tables, the dimension tables, as reference tables. So the third tip I have is use JSONB data to store unstructured data, right? And JSONB data type to store unstructured data. And the advantages are, number one, it simplifies your schema, right? So you can have a single table to store a variety of data. So here, if you see, I'm having the payload column, which stores like, say, a commit or a pull request, like different, like, you know, varieties of data, which have different, like, you know, representation can be stored in a single JSONB column, right? And the second advantage is Postgres also gives you the ability to search through the JSONB column very efficiently using JIN indexes, right? And the third is JSONB brings NoSQL capabilities to the Postgres world. So you have the power of like querying structured and semi-structured data together, right? And because of the JSONB data type. And last but not the least, this is helpful in implementing, you know, workloads that require scale. A good example is the time series and IoT bucket that I talked about, right? So you use cases that involve like, you know, events, logs, can, you know, leverage the JSONB data type to store structured, semi-structured and unstructured data. So the fourth tip I have here is time series partitioning on distributed tables, right? As you observed, like we distributed the events table on the user ID. I can also partition the events table on a time column. Here, if you see the created at, and here I created, you know, monthly partitions, right? Like a partition for January, February, July, August, etc. The advantage is it helps filtered querying with timestamp filters. So if your queries have timestamp filters, under the covers, Citus would do partition pruning and route it to the right, like partitions where the data exists, and you know it would improve the query efficiency. Second, it also helps efficient expiry, right? So for the older data, you can just run the drop table command instead of running a delete, and delete is expensive, as you know, right? Like it can, you know, cause bloat and vacuuming issues. Third, you can also archive older data through columnar. So like if you have like, say, you know, data that is older than 6 months and you don't query it that often, you don't update it that often, then you can, you know, you can use the columnar storage format that Citus provides to compress and archive that data, right? And still query it, right? And last but not the least, time series partitioning along with distributed tables is common in implementing time series workloads, right? Where you distribute on an ID column, like, you know, the user ID, and create partitions based on time. The here, if you see, Citus provides you time series APIs to, you know, simplify partitioning, archival, and expiry. So there are like, there is an API for automatic data partitioning. If I run this command, it automatically creates partitions in the future and in the past. For data archival, you know, there is another command where, you know, it converts the older partitions into columnar format. And for data expiry, there is another command which will, you know, expire all the partitions that are older. So the tip 5 I have is scope queries to shard key where possible, right? So all the four initial four tips are more related to schema and data model, right? Like this one is more, you know, related to the queries. So wherever, you know, semantically it makes sense, you scope the queries based on the distribution column. And a classic example is multi-tenant SaaS workloads, right? Like where, you know, all the queries are tied to a tenant, which is, you know, accessing the application, right? So here, you know, I'm for this particular like table, for this particular query update, right? Like I'm having the company ID filter, and this avoids unnecessary fan out and helps query latency, right? And this is more relevant in transactional workloads, right? Like for analytical workloads, you want to like, you know, parallelize the queries, but for transactional workloads, wherever possible, you want to like, you know, scope them based on the distribution column. So just to summarize, these are like, you know, the 5 tips for distributed data modeling with Postgres. I'm sure that like if you follow these 5 tips, you will have a great experience with Citus. Now that we are done with data modeling, the last step is implementing that data model and taking the application to production with Citus. I don't plan to do a deep dive into this topic, but I created a checklist of different items to go through for moving the application to production, right? If you see, and this checklist includes both, it will be useful for both open source users as well as like, you know, managed service users. A couple of things I want to highlight are, say on the application migration side, right? Like you first go through the data modeling, and there is a link for like end-to-end migration guide. For data migration, you can see use tools like, you know, pgdump, pgrestore for offline migration, pgcopyDB for online migration. If you're an Azure user, you can use the pg Azure storage extension to query and load data directly from Blob, Azure Data Factory, Azure Databricks, etc. to ingest data directly into Citus and so on and so forth. I also have like, you know, ops related aspects like, you know, deployment management, high availability setup, upgrades, disaster recovery, metrics and monitoring, et cetera, which are very crucial in, you know, running the application in production with Citus. So I have links to them. You can feel free to take a look at them after the talk. So with that, right, like I would like to show you a demo of, you know, the various features that the managed service provides to let you run Citus at a production grade on Azure, right? So let me share my that part of the screen. So what I did was prior to this session, I created a Citus cluster using Azure Cosmos DB for PostgreSQL, right? And this is the Citus cluster. And this one is a single node deployment, if you see. And it has the latest PostgreSQL version, which is Postgres 15, and the latest Citus version, which is Citus 11.2, right? And it has a single node with like 2 vCores and 8 gigs of memory, right? So the managed service provides like a ton of features, like some of them include, say, like in-place upgrades, right? So I can just click this button and like, you know, do an in-place upgrade during a scheduled maintenance, during like a regular maintenance, right? And this one, I don't need to upgrade because like, the Citus and the Postgres versions are already the latest ones, right? There is also like the start-stop feature, which lets you save costs, right? And this is suitable for your like, you know, dev and test clusters, right? Like if you're not using them, you can just stop and like save costs. There's also like, you know, point-in-time recovery feature, right? Where I can, you know, create a cluster at a given point in time up till the last minute, right? So here, if you see, I can do it like until the last minute and spin up a cluster. This is the DR story, right? And the backups are triple replicated across like different availability zones. And, you know, in case of like, say you drop a table unexpectedly, you can always, you know, use the point in time recovery feature to recover a cluster recover the cluster right before, you know, you drop the table, right? And then there is also the restart feature where you can in place, you know, restart the cluster, right? The other features are you have scale, right? In place, you can either vertically scale up the node, right? Like up till 64 V cores and, you know, 2 terabytes of storage, this particular node, or you can also, you know, scale out, right? If you see, like, I can scale from 1 node to 3 nodes, right? And I can go up to 16 terabytes per node, right? So in this particular deployments, I would have, like, you know, 48 terabytes. And from a compute standpoint, I can go to, like, you know, 96 vCores and 672 gigs of memory per node, right? So this is the distributed part, right? So you are getting Postgres in a distributed distributed like environment. Then you have networking features where you can create, like, you know, private endpoints, right? This is for, like, enterprise grade security. You can also set up firewall rules, right, to restrict, you know, what IPs that your database should have access to. There are connection strings for different applications, right? And there is also inbound PG bouncer, right? So, like, if I click on this, it's just like a change of the connection string from port 5432 and 6432. And the managed service, like, has inbuilt PG bouncer. So you don't need to worry about that. And this helps with, you know, connection pooling, right? And then you have coordinate and node parameters that you can change, right? And if it was a multi-node deployment, you would have, like, you know, worker node parameters as well that you can control. These are various Postgres and Citus configurations, right? And then you have roles where you can create, like, you know, multiple roles. You have the shard rebalancer, right? This is the horizontal scale out feature, right? So when I, you know, add nodes and kick off the rebalance, this tab would show you, you know, what is the progress of the rebalance, how much is left, how long it will take, and so on and so forth. Then I have, like, you know, the global replication feature where I can spin up, like, you know, read replicas in a different region in just, like, a couple of clicks, right? So I can, this cluster is in East US, I can spin it up in, like, you know, any region. And this is for, like, you know, DR reasons, right? Or it could be even for offloading your internal analytics, right? Like, you don't want to put load on the existing cluster. So you spin up a replica and, like, offload your, you know, internal, like, analysis on that particular cluster. So from a monitoring standpoint, like, there are insights, as you're seeing, which will show you, like, you know, the most important metrics, right? And then there is alerts. So you can create alerts based on various metrics. So these are all the signals that are present, right? I can do it based on, you know, the CPU, the memory percent, the connections, the number of connections, and so on and so forth. I have the metrics tab, or deeper dive into, like, different metrics, right? And insights is more crisp view of the important metrics. And the metrics tab is, like, you know, all the metrics that the service provides. And then there is logs as well, where you can run different queries, right? So here I'm just running this query, right? Like, where I'm getting the last 10 logs, right? And yeah, so these are all the, you know, managed service benefits, right? Like, to run, you know, production grade Citus deployments. And with that, I would like to end my talk, right? And so to summarize, you can go through this deck as a reference for your journey to get onboarded to Citus. Happy testing. Thank you.